The Holy Gospel according to Luke, chapter 15, beginning to read from verse 1 to 3 and then 11 to 32. Praise and glory to God. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear him, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Verse 11, as he continues, Jesus continues, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, 'How many of my father's hired men have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed a fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you killed a fattened calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.'"
I don't know how many times I've heard the gospel of the prodigal son preached. I'm sure you've heard it many, many times before. Well read there by Matt, thank you. There's so much in this story, I should have asked everyone to bring a sleeping bag. But I'm not going to delve into the deep theology behind it or things that you've probably heard over and over again. Just going to look at the three characters that Jesus presents his listeners with. First character that he presents us with is, of course, the younger son. an errant, self-absorbed person. Person who knows what's owed to him and grabs it, totally oblivious of the short or long-term consequences for himself, or sadly for those around him. He is purely focused on the here and now and how he can benefit himself. And there's the second character, a person who knows the outcome, yet exhibits the love that can only come from someone who deeply cares for another. In this story, it's a father figure, a person who knows where this will eventually lead, how short-sighted and self-serving this behavior is, and yet he still acts in a way that is almost countercultural, almost against the brain of normal behavior, because he does not impede his younger son's journey, but allows him, the free choice to make decisions for himself. Decisions that will lead to inevitable mistakes. But this is the behavior demanded by love. Free will for others to make mistakes. We need to understand here that the father also had multiple choices. He could have said no and removed the son's access to the inheritance, maybe gone as far as written him out of the will so that he couldn't spend all his money. That way, he could protect his son. That he could stop him from wasting his inheritance by removing the inheritance itself. Another option the father had was that he could have just given him some cash, maybe sold a cow or something, to allow this determined, headstrong boy to have some pocket money for a short vacation, in effect saying to his son, take this small amount of money and go away for a few weeks and let off some steam and then come back, you'll feel so much better. But that would not have sorted the son's issues. He would still be that same self-centered personality he is now, except he would have a suntan and be more relaxed. But the father respects the son and gives him what he demands, knowing full well the consequences of this decision. And yet, in the father's heart, he never severs the son's opportunity to return. Many of us may remember there used to be a poster that said, if you love someone, set them free. If they come back, they're yours forever. If they don't, they never were. The father had a no-choice decision. He had to let him go and trust that the love he had built into him as a child would bring the child back to him. But it might be good to note here that the son's decision was costly to the father. The culture of the day would not have had the father drawing some money out of the bank to give him his share, or maybe a mortgage to raise money. This demand of the son would have probably caused land and assets being sold, up to half of the estate that the boy demanded, half of what the father owned. And it would have been very, very public. Let us not pretend that this was a transaction that was handled over the kitchen table. Think about this for just a moment. The father is still alive. He hasn't died. The son has taken his share of his inheritance prior to the father's death. 50% of the father's assets. This would have been raised by some means, and given to the son. The father, who is still living, now has only 50% of his assets, and they belong to his other son. The father now only has 50% of the land and the animals and whatever else he had to create an income. And he has to deal with the other son, who also is confined now to 50% of the property to earn his income. Because prior to the arrogant son's decision, they would have shared the income of 100% of the property. And yet, the father still gives the son what he wants. And now, the father waits and waits, daily looking out for the wayward son to return. And still, he waits. But friends, we often gloss over the third character, the eldest son. He now has the inheritance of everything that is left. In fact, the scripture in Luke 15, verse 35 says, "Son," the father speaking to him, "son, you are always with me, and all that is mine is yours." He's not being metaphorical here. He's literally saying, "I'm living with you now, and the 50% left of my estate will be yours when I die. Your brother has had his cut. It won't be split again." But the elder son is jealous of the short-term fun the son of his father has had. Note here that he distances himself from even being related to the younger brother. How sad is that? He complains even when the brother comes home and repents. He moans that the son has been welcomed home. I wonder, was he expecting that the younger son would have his face rubbed in his own excrement and banished from his father's sight? Was that what he wanted? You see, God did not send Jesus to laugh at our misfortunes or poke fun at us. When we mess up and break his heart, he calls us back to himself through Christ. And through Christ, he sees us as worthy and forgives us freely. But in this parable, the elder son wants none of it. Well, actually, he wants all of it. And he wants to ensure his younger brother suffers forever for his mistakes and selfish and wanton living. Friends, if only we could leave that story there and not have to consider what Jesus is saying and what is his point. I'm challenged as to who I am in this parable. Far too often, I'm not the father. I'm not the one who welcomes back the ones who have hurt me, the ones who have disappointed me, the ones who have stolen their friendship or their trust from me. Far too often, I am the selfish younger brother who wants things my way and to my taste. I'm the one who needs gratification right now and to blazes with the collateral damage my choices will make to my future or how that will impact on others. I'm also the one who finally gets the guilts and decides to seek my Heavenly Father for forgiveness and get back on track. But if I'm honest, sometimes that doesn't last too long. In fact, I find there are times when I am simply justifying my actions and getting forgiveness so I can justly do it all again later. And then there's times when I'm the older brother, as I struggle with those who appear to be getting their cake and eating it too. Personally, there are times recently when I've been looking at pastors in other centres. With their big churches, their lights and their music, with hundreds attending and their nice clothes, and I get jealous. And I try to remind God that I'm doing the groundwork and I'm trying to remain faithful and focused in an extremely difficult season. I'm here trying to keep the doors open, Lord, and reaching people with the gospel. Why can't I have some of their flashy stuff and bulging offerings? And so I'm thinking the point that Jesus is trying to make is that maybe we are all one or the other. Or maybe we're both at times. I certainly know that I am. And I also know that really am I the Father. The Father is the one who sees good in these people and also the potential in them both. The younger will never be rejected and will always have a safe place to be and will be provided for. And so the older one doesn't need to feel threatened by that or jealous that somehow the welcome extended to his younger brother will alter or diminish the acceptance that he has. Actually, it's the complete opposite. The younger brother is seen by his father as the one who acted well, not the elder brother. And the elder brother could do well to recognize and acknowledge that. No one would ever say the reconciliation between these siblings is going to be flash or straightforward. But one thing is common to them both. They both messed up. They both were arrogant and short-sighted. They both have no complaint on the other without turning that back on themselves. And so my challenge this morning, which brother are we? And how do we reconcile that? How do we reconcile that with God and with each other? Hear me clearly. We will need to exhibit exactly this reconciliation when we come back, when mandates are lifted and passes and restrictions and all the other COVID stuff is behind us. Not just here in church, but out there with friends and colleagues and family. And my friends, we need to be the bigger person in all of this and be the first to reconcile if that is needed. Too many people across this nation have acted badly towards each other without acknowledging their own errancy. And there are so many hurt people and bruised relationships all around us. We could do well to begin that process with ourselves and reconcile ourselves back to God. Shall we begin to do that now? So, Lord, hear my prayer. Search me, O God, and show me where I have let you down, where I've hurt others, and where I've lied to myself. Show me where I can reconcile with those I have treated less than I would expect to be treated myself. Show me where I have expected people to have my point of view instead of being willing to be shown the errancy of my position and listen to them. Maybe I could have learnt something. Help me, Lord, to not be so easy to be offended and more willing to be accepting. Help me exhibit to others the love and forgiveness you have shown to me through your Son, Jesus. It is only through the guidance and the ministry of your Spirit that I can achieve this. And I welcome you into my heart this day and forever. Amen.